So good morning, everyone. And yes, so today I'm going to talk to you more about the research rather than the theoretical thing behind toxicity monitoring in the environment and work that I've been doing at UC Davis. So I left you with this slide last week. What are the promises of ecotoxicology genomics? What can we actually do? And one of the reasons that I like using genomics or transcriptomics, to be more correct, is that we can do two things. We can understand the mechanism of action of a contaminant. We can actually look at it in various different ways. We can do intelligent testing strategies. We can look at activity relationships. We can look at individual pathways that are affected by the contaminants, and especially if you're looking at a whole suite of genes, you're looking at the entire genome, you can get a lot of information that can be related to one species, from one species to another as well, from a functional perspective. With that, you can actually get a risk assessment understanding of why a particular contaminant, pesticide, or pharmaceutical needs to be regulated. On the other side, and else that I've been doing, is they kind of go hand in hand, is that you can create diagnostic fingerprints. So the same as human beings have fingerprints, contaminants have a particular mode of action, and you can create a particular fingerprint for each of the contaminants. And this is dependent on concentration as well. And this gives us a lot of information on the effect identification, so we know what's happening. But sometimes we can also identify what the contaminant is or what contaminant classes are likely to be within a mixture. And where my research is aiming towards, predominantly work is in the field of biomarkers, which encompasses all of these. Generally, a biomarker is considered as an individual measure of a response to a particular function. With genes, with microarrays, transcriptomics, you can look at thousands of biomarkers at once and then correlate the responses to them. I don't know if you've seen a microarray, but this is one of the microarrays. It has about 20,000 genes on it. If you hold it, don't worry. If you hold it to the light at a different angle, you can see something black in the background. You'll be able to see spots on it. You can count them all if you like. So that's a microarray that I printed at UC Davis a few years ago. I'm no longer using those. It's an idea. So I use ecotoxicogenomics as one particular biomarker. Or what are the benefits from using it? Using biomarkers individually, and that particular biomarker very well. Skills, personnel, and the equipment to actually work on that individually. And you need a lot of material generally, to the protein level, levels you're looking at, histology, for example. You're using a lot of material. With genomics, you need very, very little material. Let's just give you tissue to extract RNA from. And, you know. I'm on a line that's not muted, and I can hear you cracking in the background. Not that it's a problem for me. And another thing that we can do is by using species homology or differences, similarities between species, not only for fish, for any species, we can actually use model species as a basis for comparing among models. Species like Delta Smelt, which is what I've been working for over the last 7-8 years, we can actually take an organism that we know nothing about, sequence the transcriptome of that, and annotate it, and then identify what those genes are by that we know of. And this is what I'm doing. So we can also use a model species, expose that to a contaminant, and then compare it directly to an exposure of a non-model species as well. So on the internet, there are several databases that hold a lot of information. In fact, whenever I publish any research using genomics, to be able to publish it, I need to deposit all my data in a repository. The GEO, or Gene Expression Omnibus, is one such place that I can put the data in. I put my microarray design, all the genes up there. And what I'm showing on this slide is a list of, I've highlighted the fish species, that's what I'm working on predominantly, but there are lots of invertebrates in there as well. And what I'm highlighting here is just the number of entries on the database per species of studies that people have done. On the bottom right-hand side, you can see the Delta Smelt Hypometer Transpacificus. There's 22 data sets and publications that I have submitted in there. So this is just a picture. As I say, I've highlighted the fish, but there are lots of other species there. In my lab at UC Davis, we have a sequence of transcriptome for Delta Smelt, the inland silver side, and we are starting to work on the longpole smelt, which are fish species of interest in California. And so did you want to find out? So anyway, so this, so we've got microarrays. We're working with a company called Agilent that actually prints the microarrays for us. And we have, for Delta Smelt, there's about 18,000 features on there. There's approximately 12,000 genes. For the inland silver side, we have over 14,000 individual genes on there. And longfin smelt, we're yet to find out how many genes we'll actually identify. But in my past life back in the UK in 2003, I sequenced a transcriptome for Daphnia magna, and we've done a lot of work on microarrays on Daphnia magna in that study. I'm going to present to you a couple of the studies that we've done there in an amalgamated way. And then a collaborator of mine, a colleague, you may know Helen Poynton, she was from UC Berkeley, also worked with Don Weston. In fact, they've published a paper on Ailella Azteca recently on different sensitivity studies. She has sequenced the transcriptome for Ailella Azteca and has microarrays available for that. These are two species that we are trying to work with on jointly. In fact, Helen worked on Daphnia magna microarrays at the same time that I did as well. So Daphnia magna, the study that we did in the UK, or studies that we did in the UK, we were trying to correlate the gene expression and exposure to various contaminants with what we saw at population level. So we wanted to understand not only if a contaminant affected reproduction, why and how. And we developed a system which is an image analysis system where essentially we have a big beaker or tank full of Daphnia magna, and instead of counting them, Bill Payne tried to count them all individually. We developed this software that can actually just capture a picture and convert that into a pixelated black and white image. And we just use the software to count the number of pixels present in there. And so there's not a one-to-one correlation on the manual counts that you'll have. You have here, this graph here is the manual counts on the x-axis, and then what the image analysis software has given us on the y-axis. There's not a one-to-one correlation, but there's still a very strong correlation and a very more of a biomass. The reason we're not getting one-to-one is because a lot of the individuals overlap each other in the tank. So we could have optimized that and made it a bit like a PPS individual. But another nice thing that we liked about this is that not only can we count the classify them according to size based on the number of pixels within a group. And the graph on the right-hand side shows an example of the number of neonates, juveniles, and adults over a 14-day era reproduction test. So on this slide, I just have an example on a study that we conducted on ibuprofen. And the top left-hand graph shows the increasing concentration of ibuprofen and how the population growth rate actually declined over a 14-day period to a point that at the highest concentration of 18 milligrams per liter, we had, so first of all, I must say we had no mortality whatsoever in this 14-day period. We exposed a group of juveniles, 24-hour-old Daphnia, and we counted the reproduction of a 14-day test. What we found is we had no mortality, but if you look at this other graph in the middle on the top, we have it shows the different classifications of neonates, juveniles, and adults per concentration in the lipoprotein. The individuals at the highest concentration had, they were all there, they grew, they were large, mature organisms, but they were non-reproductive. So ibuprofen arrested the reproduction in Daphnia magna at that concentration. Now with microarray analyses, we were able to understand why and how this was happening. Now I'm not gonna bore you by going through this graph here, but there are a number of key genes and proteins, cyclooxygenase, and prostaglandins that are responsible for the activity, or ibuprofen acts upon those key proteins that end up in the arrest of phylogenesis. What the actual drawing of the Daphnia magna here shows that these are the genes that we actually ended up measuring that were significantly responding to ibuprofen. Juvenile hormones, oogenesis, the telogenin, was all downregulated in these adult data. So this is the kind of information that we can gather from an exposure. We were able to directly link what we were measuring as gene expression with what we saw at population growth levels. So that's from a functional aspect, mechanistic understanding. As I said at the start of this talk, another thing that we can do with genomics is profiling or fingerprinting, if you like. Now, every human being, we all know this, has a particular fingerprint. There are certain algorithms that are present there that we can actually identify one individual from another. And we're trying to use this concept in toxicogenomics to be able to understand if we can identify a particular contaminant over another, say, one pesticide, a pyrethroid against an organophosphate, by using the gene expression, can we differentiate between the two? Can we identify what contaminant it is? And this is just an example of different profiles according to different genes, and I've just drawn roughly 12 genes. So if we have an unknown contaminant, we can measure the expression of these genes. We can create our own profile, and then as we gradually build a database of profiles for these contaminants, we can actually compare and identify what contaminant is likely driving that, that profile. So we can actually use it in toxicity identification evaluation assessments as well. Now, the graph at the top, the figure at the top here is for the heat map. And essentially, it's a graphical representation of up and down regulation, how the genes are actually changing. And it's a way that I like using this cluster analysis, hierarchical clustering, because it gives me a direct visualization of what the differences are. And the rest of the slides that I'll be showing you, red means that the gene has been upregulated, green means that it's been downregulated. I've recently changed this to blue and yellow because I'm actually red being colorblind, and I know that many people are, of course, but I can see that because they're separating that. So Erica Fritsch was a graduate student at UC Davis. She's now completing a postdoc in her colleague's laboratory. You may have heard of her, but she's been working on triclosan, which is an antibacterial agent present in many things that we use, hand soaps, a lot. And this is an example of how a suite of genes shown on the top of this graph can differentiate between different concentrations of triclosan, and we have different responses. What you see in on this red-green box here is every column is a particular gene, and every row in this case is a particular fish, which is the fathead minnow we used in this particular study. So the tool is very good for an individual compound. We can differentiate between concentrations of a contaminant. We can also, this is another study by Sebastian Bagel, who is, again, another grad student in the lab. He's gone back to Germany. He's completing a postdoc there. He did a similar suite of genes, and this is the same format as the previous one. It's slightly different genes. He compared responses between bifenthrin and piperonyl. This figure is actually one figure. I've cut it in half to fit it landscape on this slide. But what you can see is that it's completely separated by bifenthrin from piperonyl. There are a few sort of fish that are responding more similarly to others, but that is accounted for. So we get variability in fish, and it's much higher in fish than I've seen in vertebrates.
Could you humor me for a minute? So the left, the columns are the genes.
Yes.
Oh, and the rows are the individual.
Individual fish.
Of the same species.
Of the same species.
So you've got like that many fish, you try them and they give you a little bit.
Yeah, so this, so per concentration, for example, here we have bifenthrin, 0.349 or 349 nanograms per microliter. These are replicates from an exposure. And instead of analyzing the fish and taking the mean and standard deviation, what we're showing you here is the result per individual fish. There's no mean. We're using the hierarchical clustering to say, well, we throw all these fish into the data from the fish into one table and let the computer sort it out based on similarity. So it's finding a similar profile. So these two here are more similar than the others, so they will cluster it up in a dendrogram.
What's the typing at the top? I can't see.
So the typing at the top, apologies for that, these are the different genes that we measure. So
okay.
These are things like chorogenin, metallocyanin, vitellogenin,
okay.
A number of the different genes. So these are all the different genes.
I have a question.
These are the fish.
Hi, this is Shi Yang Zhang. I'm wondering what's the reproducibility of this fingerprint patterns, and will these patterns be affected by different environmental factors, for example, pH or concentration of total sediment. Yeah, I have two questions.
Yeah. Absolutely. The gene expression is affected by many, many, many parameters. At the moment, these kinds of studies differentiating between different concentrations is mainly something that you can do in a laboratory setting. But I will show you in a minute a couple of slides where we've taken it out into the field. And we've identified that. Things like pH will change the gene expression pattern, but you can also select and guide the kind of genes that you're using. So, for example, something like vitellogenin that's involved in reproduction itself won't necessarily be affected by pH, or something like sodium potassium ATPase is something that regulates the osmotic potential of an organism, so that will be affected by salinity. So you can choose to either incorporate or remove those genes that are affected by these different variables as well. So we are actually doing a study trying to identify the optimal niche of delta smelt, and we're using gene expression to select the differences between the levels of pH that they can tolerate, temperature, salinity, and we're even going towards turbidity in the sense that we're using genes that are involved in cortisol production, so looking at stress responses directly. So you're absolutely right. There are lots of things that can interfere with these responses, but we can also filter them out on pathway-specific responses.
Okay.
And
thank
I have
you.
In the genes you picked were based on that previous slide that showed that development was arrested at a certain stage, and so you isolated those.
Okay, let me backpedal a bit here. What I'm presenting here is not a continuous study. I should have mentioned this before. The different studies were not done from the purpose that I am presenting here. I've taken data from that to try and show you a picture of the outcome. This is kind of a byproduct of another study. But essentially the genes have been picked from either known functions, so that actually gone into the literature, and selected specific genes because we were trying to investigate whether bifenthrin had estrogenic impacts on the organism. We either selected them that way, or we have selected them by doing a microarray screening. So we've looked at the whole genome responses, looked at what genes were most significantly differentiated, and then said, okay, let's pick the top 100 or the top 50 or top 25 according to their functions. So this is on a small scale. You can actually do the same analysis with all 18,000 genes, but I wouldn't be able to show you this on the slide. I get migraines looking at that kind of data. This is not done with microarrays. This is done with quantitative PCR, so we can actually measure each individual gene response with a high degree of quality.
I have a question for you.
Yeah.
On the left side and the right side, there are little figures there.
Yeah.
Is that to show some sort of interrelatedness?
So,
but it's used in species differentiation, like as a cladistic type thing with the interrelation of animals.
So this is all one species.
Okay.
The left and right is actually top and bottom.
Oh, look, okay, no. What I'm talking about is at the very left of your...
The very left to the right. So that was my choice to cluster them that way. So what these bars here are showing is how similarly, these two genes are responding. You'll have a bar that will join.
Oh, okay.
Them two. So these lines show how similar they are to each other.
Okay.
And the same on the left-hand side of each one of the graphs. These lines are showing how similar these fish are responding to each other. So even though they're clustered together in this region, these two fish, so the third and the fourth one, are more similar to each other than they are to the second. Than they are to the next.
Okay.
And I won't go through the whole graph for you.
No, I understand that, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So that's kind of how it works. It works on just similarity. And it uses a Pearson correlation or whatever type of correlation you can select to do it. So the message from this is under controlled conditions in a laboratory, we can clearly separate the mode of action or the chemicals that the fish have been exposed on based on the mode of action. They are some outliers. When we take it into the field, and this you have to interpret variations here in pH, salinity, as your colleague just recently asked. This is an example, and what I'm showing here is a principal component analysis. So it's using all of the suites of genes that we had available. This is on Delta smelts, it's not the same genes as before, it's a different study. And we compared some fish that were exposed to a sample from Houghton, downstream of the wastewater treatment plant here in Sacramento. We compared them to some reference toxicant exposures that we did on chlorpyrifos, copper, ethylene valerate, and permethrin. And what a PCA does, it can separate or group up responses based on similarity as well. So it's the same as the graph that you saw before, but in a three-dimensional perspective rather than just a plain profile. And this is very preliminary data, and I wouldn't bet on this working every time. But what we have identified here is that the hood sample here highlighted in yellow, the profile that we're getting from the hood is very similar to the profile that we get from permethrin and very similar to what we're getting from chlorpyrifos. The interesting thing is that when we do analysis at that site, these are contaminants that do keep coming up. Esfenvalerate is similar. Esfenvalerate is similar, but it's still significantly different from that cluster. And that copper way down on the other end here is a completely different profile to what we found before. As I say, this is preliminary data. One of the main issues I have with this and one of the problems that I have with this is that the concentrations that we picked here are not ecotoxic. I took this data from other studies. I tried to have a look, see at what's going on. What we would need to do is actually find out what the equivalent concentrations are at that particular site to be able to do this kind of study. So we did a number of studies using profiling on Delta Smelt in particular. This graph, you don't need to see the specific details on it, but what I want you to, so we did a microarray analysis, identified genes, we did quantitative PCR to validate or create this actual heat map on selected genes. And these are responses from fish that were exposed to a number of different sites along the delta. So we have samples from Susun, Cache Lindsay, Hood, Rough and Ready, and Napa region as well, so different sites. And we did the same analysis, so we clustered the profiles of each one of these genes. But what I want you to see, if I can use this computer properly, is that there is a big glowing green section here and a red section up here. So red is upregulated, green is downregulated. I won't go into the specific genes, but what's being grouped up here by these differential colors are predominantly the type of Hood and Rough and Ready. The interesting thing about these two sites is they're both downstream of wastewater treatment plants. So we've got a high signature of wastewater treatment plant impact on the river from that. So we took the responses that we got from here. We focused the study on Hood. Is that a question? So we focused our study on Hood, and we did a study where we looked at responses upstream, downstream from the wastewater treatment discharge point. And what I'm showing on this graph, and I'll show you another graph that's probably a little bit easier to understand, is first of all, we have a lab control water against a sample from Hood, which is downstream of the wastewater treatment plant. And we're seeing significant differences in responses in different genes. Then we took an upstream, the Sacramento River at Garcia Bend here in Sacramento. We spiked that. This is a study looking particularly at ammonia effects on it. We spiked the upstream water with ammonia, and then we took wastewater treatment discharge and diluted it with river water until we got the same concentration of ammonia. So we matched our ammonia concentrations, but one was from the river and one was from the discharge. And what we found is that predominantly ammonia in the discharge and ammonia in the river responded similarly to each other, but significantly different from the upstream. So ammonia was a huge impact on it. But in some cases, the response from the discharge was a lot stronger than that just from the river. And what we took from this is that, this is the same data, exactly the same data presented on a principal component analysis. And here you see the upstream sample of Garcia Bend. Garcia Bend with ammonium added to it, and the wastewater treatment effluent diluted to the same concentration of ammonia and downstream to it. And here is our laboratory control. What we've taken from this is that, yes, they are, so there's a significant similarity between Hood downstream and the wastewater treatment plant and ammonia signatures and everything. But there's also a difference between upstream and our controls in the lab. And looking at the genes responses in a bit more detail, what we could say from this is I guess what we all know is that upstream still has contaminants in it. It's not only the wastewater discharge that contributed contaminants to the whole. So that's kind of information that we can get from profiling genomes and all that. We can also conduct specific studies that are directed to answer specific questions that we want to know. This is another study at Hood. As you can see, we do a lot of work at Hood, and this is because the Department of Water Regulations, Water Resources have a peer out there in a lab that we can do our studies at. We exposed fatted minnows here. This was a study to identify what type of responses are we getting after 14-day exposure of fish in situ. So we actually have tanks out on the field, water being pumped in from the river through the tanks and out again. And the graphs are divided in between free swimming and caged individuals. And what this means was that we had big tanks, and inside the tanks we either let the fish swim freely, or we had little cages that were floating on the surface that had the fish in it. The reason we did that is that we wanted to count mortality on a daily basis without disturbing everything of the tank, and it's difficult to look at a big tank for mortality. So we analyzed this from a gene expression perspective, and we have a number of genes that we selected for this study. ESR1 is an estrogen receptor, so it's an indication of impacts from endocrine disrupting contaminants. An increase in males generally signifies feminization in fish. These fish were not, we haven't differentiated whether they were male or female because we exposed larva fish at this stage. But what we are seeing at Hood in both our caged individual, our free swimming one, is an increase in estrogen receptor, indicating the potential for endocrine disrupting chemicals. CYP1A responds to exogenous compounds within the organism. We had an increase relative to each one of their controls. And a number of different genes that we measured indicated not only reproductive impact, but also growth and development, oxidative stress. I'm just going to go through these slides. We did this on numerous occasions. Growth and development keeps coming up as impacted upon, and also immune functions. We specific genes can actually identify the presence of viruses and the impact of viruses on an organism as well. So it's not just contaminants, but it's disease that we can measure as well. And pesticides can sometimes be beneficial if there's a disease present. But it's also what came first, the chicken or the egg, or the egg. If there's a disease in the fish and then they're exposed to contaminant, they'll suffer more stress from that contaminant. Or the disease, the contaminant can actually affect the disease. Or if they're exposed to a contaminant and then to a disease, the immune system is already affected by the contaminant. So it's a whole new kettle of worms there.
What's the exposure period for
the? So these are 14 days.
14 days.
Yeah. So Linda Djanovic, from ATL, she is currently out there waiting for it to rain. We're trying to catch a rare storm, and I don't think we're going to do that. But we're doing two 14-day periods back to back. So we have the fish exposed for 14 days. We take those down and put another set in for another 14 days. And I didn't explain that because I didn't want to go off track, but you'll see on these graphics at round 4, we had round 3, round 2, that's from different time points that we're doing the assessment. But what we're finding is, repeatedly, we're getting these responses. And we have chemical analysis, we're actually waiting for Fish and Game to get us that data to be able to match up with it so we can identify anything in particular. So that's kind of the work that we do. We do many other different things, but I didn't want to present everything. what we have been looking at, this is a particular slide that Erica Holland prepared for me, Erica Fritsch, sorry, prepared for me. She got married halfway through her PhD. And she was looking at triclosan on the slide that I presented earlier. And her focus was, so she identified that triclosan had an impact on muscle activity. It was known that it had an impact on calcium signaling in the body. So she selected a number of genes that are involved in muscle contraction. And what I'm showing up here on the slide is essentially a number of genes that do just that. So you have a signal that will come in to the muscle. It's a dihydropyridine receptor, DHPR. It's a protein that will signal the release of calcium from a storage chamber, and that release of calcium is what triggers the muscle contraction. What she has identified is that triclosan impacts on these two genes, so the ryanodine receptor and the dihydropyridine receptor. And it affects it to the point that they're out of synchronous. So this will signal the ryanodine receptor to actually open the chamber where the calcium is stored, but it won't close. So calcium keeps going out, and the way the muscle contraction works is by repetitive calcium binding and non-binding. And so if there's too much calcium there, there's a whole missynchronization of muscle activity, and she has seen the fish just shake and just they will exhaust themselves to death. So a lot of contaminants do that. Triclosan is one of them. And this is another study, and I'm just showing it as an example here. This was done with delta smell, and back to the ammonia study that I was presenting. But I didn't have the data from her study, so I'm showing you this. We have a motion tracking software, so we can film the fish swimming to assess their behavior. And what you see in on this slide are tracks with the motion of a single fish over a period of 2 minutes in the tank. And we have our controls on the top where the fish are all swimming, kind of more their normal behavior and everything. But when you get to the higher concentration, say 356 micrograms, this is a very high concentration. This is an acute exposure that we did. What ammonia does is it affects all the membranes, muscle, and everything. These fish were swimming in circles, they were doing backflips. Just kind of round and round and round, and it actually was quite horrible to see, but it's something that we can measure. We can measure in the laboratory, we can measure the impact caused from the gene expression. Erica Fritz was looking at the protein interaction. She actually looked at activity assays in the lab as well. So that's kind of what I want to show you. I just want to highlight most of this work has been done on pharmaceutical pesticides. To me, I don't differentiate between a pharmaceutical and a pesticide other than its application. I'm sure you agree with me. Different mode of actions. But in summary, I just want to say that transcriptomic is actually a multi-biomarker tool. You can actually use that. A lot of studies, a lot of people tend to select a particular biomarker and say, oh, let's look and see if it has this effect. With a whole genome approach using these microarrays, you can look at everything. You can screen it. You can, what I like saying is you can actually interrogate the organism and ask them what it is that we're supposed to be looking at. We can use it for a number of things. Contaminants, disease, and mentioned, a colleague asked about pH and other stressors. Yes, environmental stressors affect the signaling. Other parameters that I haven't mentioned is age, the age-specific responses of the organism that we can differentiate between as well. We can look at multiple stresses, combined stresses, mixtures, and we can use this tool within TIE processes. I don't know why there's an and there between identification and evaluation. But more importantly, we can use this as a predictive tool, a tool to predict long-term effects. We're currently doing exposures of inland silver sides to bifenthrin, where we expose them at a juvenile stage for 14 days and then place them in tags to recover and reproduce, and we see significant differences in reproduction, gonadosomatic indices and other parameters after they presumably recover as well. So here's my slide just indicating that I like placing the organism that I'm testing on a chair and asking them what we're supposed to be looking at it rather than anything else. And I showed you a bridge image last week of how we're trying to link one side to another. So the mechanistic responses to a population response. We're not quite there yet. There are lots of gaps that we need to fill in to construct and finish that bridge. There are a few that have already been validated and acknowledged, such as the reproductive vitellogenin, choriogenin studies. We know a lot about that and what will occur at later stages, but there's a lot of work to be done. And